Welcome everybody to the after lunch session. Well, I guess everyone knows how this works. You type your questions in Discord and then I can ask them to Otfried, maybe during the talk if there's something urgent or at the end. And with this, well, I'll present our next speaker, who's Otfried Gune, and he's going to talk about the quantum marginal problem. Please, Otfried.
Yes, thank you very much. And I would also like to thank the organizers for inviting me here. And yes, it was a nice conference so far. Unfortunately, didn't happen last year. Anyways, good. So I will talk a little bit about the quantum marginal problem. And this is essentially, I will talk about two works. And this has been done together with Felix Huber, who is now was a PhD student here, but who's now in Krakow, Shaun Nguyen from my group, Jens Sievert from Bilbao, Timo Simnacher, who is a PhD student in my group, Nikolai Widerka, who was a PhD student in my group and is now in Düsseldorf, and finally Xiao Dong Yu, who is a postdoc in my group. Okay, so what is a quantum marginal problem, or just how can I motivate it? I mean, I would like to start, with the following picture, which you may know, which was a cover from a book, I think in the 70s or so, called Gödel-Escher-Bach. And I found this a very nice object because this is a real object. It's not a computer animation and it's not from a 3D printer. And these are two pieces of wood. So if you shine light on them appropriately, you get this letters G, E, and B. Yeah, and this is really, it's not a computer simulation. You can see here some strings, yeah, where it's somehow, where they're connected. So it's a real object. So the question is it surprising that you can make such an object? Yeah, where the letters somehow appear as you wish. And one can go a little bit further, and you can actually sharpen this observation in the following sense. You can build such a thing, which I would call a digital sundial. So this is an object, actually this comes now from a 3D printer. And well, the sun shines on it and you see here's a time. So it's 1320. And as soon as the sun turns a bit, at some point, this will be 1325 and then 1330 and so on. So it's like a digital little clock driven by the sun. And actually these things you can buy in the internet. They're actually not expensive. And so what do they illustrate? They actually illustrate some theorem in geometry by Falconer in 1987. Namely, that if you have a set of shadows in all spatial directions in two dimensions, then there is a three-dimensional object which has these shadows up to some measure zero. Yeah, so in principle, you can even make this sundial more precise that you have some seconds, but of course, then it's very complicated to fabricate. But you can always have it, if you have an arbitrary set of shadows, you can always find a three-dimensional object that has these shadows, period. Yeah, up to some measure zero, so in principle, the shadows might contain some one-dimensional lines and so on. Okay, this is of course quite classical. So what does it have to do with quantum mechanics? And maybe first, okay, now we're moving from shadows to probability distributions. You can, for instance, ask the question, well, I have some probability distribution of three variables, and now you want to reconstruct it from these marginals. And you have these three marginals, and the question is, can you reconstruct this total probability distribution, or can't you do that? And this is already not such a trivial question. And just to give you an example, yeah, once you make ask the question, if you have four random variables, yeah, with values plus or minus one, and you know just these marginals which are pointed in red here, like AC, AD, BD, BC, and BD. So then you can ask, okay, I have these marginals. When is there a global probability distribution having these marginals? And actually, this question is easy to answer, and actually this is now connected with quantum mechanics, because in principle it's known by, this is theorem by Fine in 81, that this holds if and only if this probability distribution fulfills the CHSH equality. Okay, so let's move now further to quantum mechanics. I mean, in quantum mechanics, we don't just have probability distributions or shadows, we have quantum states. And then essentially you can ask very similar questions, namely essentially how the parts of a quantum system relate to the whole. Yeah, for instance, you can ask it for certain properties. You can ask how do some local properties determine the global properties of a quantum system. And you can also ask, if you essentially look for all properties, you can just ask, is the global state determined by these local states? Yeah. And just to stress that this is not only a theoretical question, but that this has really some application. It's meaning, for instance, that if you do statistical mechanics and have some two-body Hamiltonian, this is essentially a question that you often ask. And because if something is a ground state of a two-body Hamiltonian, that means that by looking at the two-body marginals only, you can uniquely determine the state. Yeah, because I mean the two-body Hamiltonian only looks at the reduced two-body density matrices. Yeah, and if this is a ground state of it, there must be some unique relation between the global state and the two-body marginals. Okay, so of course, I mean this problem is a bit older, and there have been some works on it. And in the following 3 minutes, I will maybe tell you some about the known results, or just also to motivate why we're looking at it. So, for instance, there's an old paper by Higuchi and Sudbury in 2000, which essentially asks the following question. So, if you have a bipartite pure state, then it's when typically one calls it maximally entangled, if the marginals, so the single partite reduced density matrices, are maximally mixed. I mean, this is, for instance, the case for Bell states or for higher dimensional isotropic states and so on. Now you can ask, okay, if I have, for instance, 4 qubits, do I manage to find a state where all the two-body marginals are maximally mixed? So if I take a bipartition of AB versus CD, and do I then find some state where AB versus CD, the marginals are mixed, but also AC versus BD and so on, and all the possible combinations that you can have. So does such a state exist? And actually what they proved in this paper is essentially that such a state does not exist for 4 qubits. You can actually see it quite directly because 4 qubits is not such a big space. And yes. So the question is now, what happens in general for n particles? Can I also have a state, for instance, for 6 particles where all the 3-body marginals are mixed and mixed? Okay, what is another question? I mean, another line of research refers to the question, is the global state uniquely determined by its marginals? And so one of the pioneering papers was by Linden, Popescu, and Wouters, where they showed that nearly all pure 3-qubit states are determined by the reduced 2-body marginals. And actually, what I meant by determined is means determined among all states. I mean, not only determined among the mixed, among the pure states, but determined among all pure and mixed states. Yeah, and because of this, you can say, okay, this essentially also means that nearly all pure 3-qubit states can be written as a ground state of a 2-body Hamiltonian. Yeah, and so this essentially shows you already that then this physical question of which states can be prepared by 2-body Hamiltonians comes into this game. If you ask more practical, you can also go further. For instance, there are works like this one from 2008, with Martin van den Nest, Chris Ludmer, Wolfgang Dürr, and Hans Brieger, where they essentially ask, okay, we have some states which are called graph states, which are known to be useful for things like measurement-based quantum computation. So the question is, can we prepare it by some cooling down some system with a 2-body Hamiltonian? And actually what they showed is that graph states cannot be exact ground states of 2-body Hamiltonians. And if one approximates them, the energy gap vanishes. Yeah. Okay, good. So these are some known results. And yeah, now you can ask some general questions. And in principle, there are 3 lines of questions that you can ask. Yeah, so the one thing is you go from the marginals to the global state. Yeah, so you're given a set of reduced state, then is there a global state compatible with all these marginals? And you can ask it in several forms. You can ask whether there's a mixed state compatible with it or a pure state compatible with it. But I mean, essentially, this is the way where it goes. You start with some marginals, and you go to some try to find a global state. On the other hand, you can also start from a global state and look at the marginals and then ask, was this global state uniquely determined by them? Yeah, obviously, I mean, if you start with a global state, then it's clear that there must be a global state compatible with marginals. But then you can ask, okay, was the state uniquely determined by that? And this was a paper by Lynn, Kupesko, and Mutas that I mentioned, essentially. And then, of course, you can also go down to certain properties. You can ask, if I've given a global state, which properties can I infer by looking at the marginals only? Yeah, for instance, can I say something about entanglement, about non-locality, whatever, Fisher information, whatever you're interested in? Can you do this by looking at the two-body marginals only? And a typical tool to investigate this are, for instance, like spin-squeezing inequalities, which only look at the two-body marginals. Okay, so essentially my talk will be mainly about the first question. Given a set of reduced state, is there a global state compatible with them? And essentially, I will talk about two questions. So I'll first talk about this question of these maximum entangled states. In a sense, are there some n particle pure states for which many marginals are maximally mixed? Yeah, okay, the question is how many you can make maximally mixed, but you want to make as many marginals maximally mixed as possible. And then in the second part of the talk, I will consider more general the question. What's this pure state marginal problem? So instance, we have a bunch of marginals and you ask, is there a pure state compatible with it? Okay, good. So this is roughly my outline. So let's start with the first part. And this is about this maximally entangled state. And actually these states are also called absolutely maximally entangled state. And before talking about them, I should a little bit apologize. I mean, I found this notion of absolutely maximally entangled state. I mean, I found this name a little bit ridiculous, to be honest. But okay, this was not invented by us. Yeah, so in principle, because if you say something is absolutely maximally entangled, it sounds really like super entangled. Yeah, but I think it's okay. Yeah, they're just highly entangled multi-qubit state or multi-particle states. So what does it mean? First, what is the definition? I mean, we're looking for some n particle state where many reduced states are maximally mixed. And in principle, every bipartition should be maximally entangled. And this means that essentially all the marginals on n over two particles must be maximally mixed. One has to be careful a little bit because if n is odd, then this is not possible. Yeah, so because an n over two is not an integer. And then you have to take the smallest, you have to reduce the number a bit. Yeah, because once if you have a three particle, if you have three particles, then you cannot make the two-body marginals maximally mixed, just for the simple reason of the Schmidt decomposition, because the state has then only, for instance, for qubits, only Schmidt rank two. But you can still, in principle, at least achieve that this is maximally mixed. Okay, and actually I should say, examples of these states are known. Yeah, for instance, the simplest case, of course, is a Bell state. It's for n equal to two, yeah, to fulfill this. For three qubits, there is the GZ state. And for higher qubit numbers, like the five qubits and six qubits, there are also states which are code words of certain quantum codes. I mean, I wrote them here as some funny pictures. I should maybe explain what that means. Here, I write them in terms of graph states. I mean, roughly, I will not use the formalism of graph states, but roughly the idea is that you have, for instance, you can write down a five-qubit state in the following manner, that you first, you prepare some product state with all the five qubits, and then you switch on some interaction for some time or along the connected qubits. And then you arrive at a certain state, which is then called the graph states. This has nice properties in the sense it's an eigenstate of certain operators and so on. Yeah, but that's just a translation from some graph to some state. Yeah, and you can see these connections as some interactions that you switch. Okay, and it turns out that these examples that are known for qubits are just these graph states, yeah, which is actually non-trivial. I mean, I can comment on this because yesterday there was a post on it. Okay, good. Why are these states interesting? I mean, well, okay, we first can say that they are somehow correspond to certain quantum codes. You know, if you're interested in quantum codes, you may be interested in these states. They're also useful for some secret sharing tasks or so. Okay, what is known about them? That if the local dimension is large enough, they always exist. So in principle, for instance, I told you before that for 4 qubits, the state doesn't exist. But for 4 qutrits, it exists. Yeah, and you can always, for any number of particles, you can always prove that if the local dimension goes up and up, at some point, such a state will exist. For qubits, which is the simplest case, they now exist for 2, 3, 5, and 6, which are just these graph states that are plotted here. They don't exist for n equal to 4. This was this old result by Higuchi and Sudbury. And they do not exist for n larger than 8, which follows from some general results on quantum codes. I will comment on that a little bit later. So the question is, of course, what happens for 7 qubits? Yeah. And actually, for 7 qubits, it was known that it is not a graph state, if it exists, because you can just check all the graph states. But in general, I mean, also, and this was the paper yesterday, which was difficult to see due to technical reason, but hopefully can see today, that there was a paper essentially proving that not all AME states are graph states. Yeah, so in principle, one has to look for more general things than graph states. So, but what happens for n equal to 7? And this is a question that we asked already some years ago. And well, the result is very simple to formulate. Yeah, and the first thing, okay, they don't exist. So there is just not such a state for 7 qubits. And then you can ask, okay, well, if it doesn't exist, what is the best approximation? And actually this, you can also answer that the best approximation to an absolutely maximum tangled state for 7 qubits is a state where not all of the 3-body density matrices are maximally mixed, but 32 of the 35 possible ones. And actually, this then corresponds again to a graph state, which corresponds to this nice graph. Okay, so this is just the result. I will maybe shortly give you an idea how to prove that, because later I come back to that. And also because the proof is quite simple. I mean, I will not go into too much details. You don't have to be afraid. So what is the main idea, or what is the main ingredient? Let's put it in the proof. Well, the first ingredient is that if you have a density matrix and also a pure state, a projector into pure state, you can always write it in some Bloch decomposition, yeah, which is essentially decomposition to Pauli's. And then you have something like an identity, and you have some terms which you can sort according to the number of particles they act on. Yeah, for instance, you have some 1-body correlations, you have some 2-body correlations, some 3-body correlations, and so on. And this is general for qubits, yeah. So, and then essentially you say, okay, let's assume that such an AME state exists. Then it would have 2 properties. Because then you can write down the Schmidt decomposition for arbitrary bipartitions, and you know it's a maximally certain things have to be maximally mixed, so you know a lot of things about the Schmidt coefficients. And from that, you can then first see that the 5-qubit reduced state squared has to be roughly a projector up to some factor. And also that the state itself is an eigenstate of its own reduction. Yeah, so if it takes a reduced state and apply it to the same state again, then it's the same state, and this also holds for other things. And actually, these are things which are just follow from the Schmidt decomposition. It's not complicated. And then you can just calculate a bit. Yeah. So you take some of these equations, you insert this here, and you use some properties of the Pauli matrices. And at some point, you arrive at a contradiction. Yeah. Okay. I mean, if you want to go into details, you have to look for the paper. What I want to stress here, and this is later important for my later argument, is that actually this proof does not involve any advanced mathematics. Yeah, I mean, of course, you have to be very clever to find it, and Felix did it, but it's not like that you need to something like C star algebras, whatever, tra-la-la. Yeah, so in principle, it's somehow low-level mathematics. Good. Okay, so in this way, you can prove that such an AME set doesn't exist. So now you may ask, okay, what's about the general situation? Yes, if I have an arbitrary number of particles, an arbitrary number of dimension, can I find such a state? And actually, there are, oops, yes. So there are some general strategies to exclude such AME states. And I will not go into details, but I can give you some idea. So one idea is there's some things like shadow inequalities, which essentially looks like that. So if you have two positive operators, and then you can look at essentially, you can look at the reduced states. Yeah, so you trace out something, you trace something from Y, you multiply it and you trace the rest. So this is essentially just a number. You take, so S is an arbitrary subset. And you look at the, so look at the reduced states, multiply them, and trace out again. And then you have put some coefficient in front, which is alternating signs. But then essentially the statement is that this number, what is written here, is positive. Yeah, okay. Just believe me. Yeah, so if you don't know it, so this is this you can prove and fine. So how, what does it tell us about AME states? Well, how can such a relation tell us something about AME states? Well, in principle, it goes like that. So let's assume that such an AME state exists. Then we can just take this inequality and take x equal to y, these two opposites same, and equal to this AME state. And then because this is an AME state, I mean, here there are some reduced states. The thing, yeah. So since this is an AME state, we know some properties of reduction, namely that certain reductions are maximally mixed, and this essentially we can insert here. So if you have such an expression and have an AME state, we know many of these terms, and from that we then conclude, okay, but if we then arrive at a contradiction that we cannot fulfill this inequality anymore. If we know, if we fix some of these terms, then we are done. Yeah, because then such just tells us that the AME state doesn't exist. And with this trick or with similar tricks, there's a series of weight and shadow enumerators and so on, one can essentially prove that certain AME states do not exist. And this is the situation. So what is depicted here. So this is the number of parties. Here's in the upper panel, there's the even numbers. In the lower panel, there's the odd numbers. Yeah, so in principle, I can merge this into one, but this was just easy to depict. And then you can say, okay, do they exist or not? And essentially what is shown here, everything that is blue is where the states do not exist. And where you see this existence symbol, then it's known that the states exist. I should stress that this is from situation 2018, so there's a slightly updated table at this webpage. And essentially, the example from what I gave you once before, that for 7 qubits, this AME state doesn't exist, is just this blue square. Yeah, and because this doesn't exist. And here's this 4-qubit state that doesn't exist, is this blue square. So good. So this was the first part of the talk where I talk about this AME problem. And now in the second part, I will talk about some more general problem, about this marginal problem, where I do not just have some given marginals and I want to know whether the state, whether such a state exists. So mathematically, that means that I have essentially some marginals and just as a set of marginals. And I want to ask, is there some pure state compatible with that or not? And in order to discuss this, so first I should stress, wait, that there, oops, can you see? Yes. There are some results, of course, known to this problem. So first one can ask a question, okay, what happens if these margins that I know are not overlapping? Yeah, so if I just know, for instance, this state, this state, and this state, so I just want to know the single particle marginals, and I do not, and since they're not overlapping, then of course, because I can always apply some unitaries, local unitaries, only the eigenvalues matter. And for that, there's a solution known, yeah, which comes from Klerschko some time ago. And the second thing is that in principle, if I have this IMD problem, then it's a special instance of this problem where I know that certain of these marginals just should be proportional to that entity. And third, I wouldn't say that this evening there's a poster, which seems to be interesting, which somehow presents some numerical approach, how to find such a global state if it exists. Okay, good. So how can we proceed with this question? So essentially, I mean, we are essentially interested in the following set, namely in all the set of compatible states. Yeah, so I can look at all the states, mixed states, that are compatible with these marginals, which I give for. And now the question is just very simple. Is there a pure state in this set? Okay, so of course, finding a pure set is a little bit difficult because the condition that something is pure is not so easy to formulate, or numerically it's very ugly. So the trick here is to go to two copies of the state. In the following sense, I can look at the convex hull of the two copies of this compatible state. So I take, here is this essentially my marginal problem. I have n particles, I know some marginals, and then ask, is there a global state compatible with these marginals? And then I define essentially my compatible state, set C, and ask the question, is there a pure state? And in order to simplify this quest for the pure state, I just look at two copies. I look at convex combinations where I have here a compatible state and here a compatible state in this form. Yeah, so something like that. This is an automatically permutation invariant. And because I have here the same state, but then essentially I look at these set of states. So now you may wonder, so what do I gain from that? Now the trick is to use some properties. And one of the properties is the property of the flip operator. Namely, if you have such a state, rho A tensor rho B, and you take trace and the flip operator, then essentially you take the trace of this product of these two matrices. And that means that if I take a state in my two copy compatible set, and I take the excitation of the flip operator, essentially I get something like the sum of these pk, and then I take the trace of these guys squared. And this is of course smaller than one because the pk are probability distribution, and these purities are of course smaller than one. Now, but what is the interesting point? Well, if I know that this, if I manage to find an example where this is equal to one, then all these guys in this decomposition must have been pure. And especially that means that there must be a pure state in the original compatible set. Yeah, and on the other hand, it's also clear that if there is a pure state in my compatible set, then of course I can just take this state as this rho k, and then I will also find something like a state in my two copy set, such that this expectation value is equal to one. Yeah. So what I can say, so essentially there's already some equivalence relation between the purity of the states in this single copy compatible set with this expectation value of the flip operator in this two copy set. Okay. And essentially then we are done already. Then we can write down already the first main result, which is the following. The statement is the following. There exists a pure global state for this marginal problem. So there exists a solution of this marginal problem if and only if the following optimization gives me a value of one. And what do I have to maximize here? I maximize exchanging the expectation value of this flip operator of my two copy set under the condition that is separable and normalized. Yeah, so it has to be something like this separable state. And of course I have to make the marginal constraint, because this guy has to fulfill some marginal constraints, which I know I have to trace out something on two copies to get essentially two times my marginal. And it's completely clear that if there is a pure state that is compatible with it, it's my marginal problem, then this optimization gives me a one. Because then essentially I just take this psi as this two copy of the state, and with this expectation of the flip operator will be just one. The only small thing that one has to show is the following, that let's assume I find something which is of this type, which gives me one here. Why? This means that it also obeys the marginal constraints. Because of the following, here I put my constraint on this global state phi, which is this mixed state on this two copy level. And the constraints that I have here from my marginal system should be on the decompositions. Wait, I can go back. So I put the constraint on this phi, but I want to have a constraint on these single terms in the decomposition. Yeah, and this is not, and there one has to think a bit, but one can prove it actually also with a few lines. But this is the only thing where the equivalence is not entirely clear. Okay, and this is one way to write the marginal problem. And the nice thing is that we have essentially reduced this marginal problem to a separability problem. Yeah, because essentially we have to characterize separable states. And that's all in order to solve the marginal problem. Okay, so then how can we proceed? Yeah, because so at the moment it's just an abstract formulation. How can we proceed? Well, first we can try to replace the separability condition with something more easy to handle. Yeah, because we all know the separability problem is itself, it's a hard problem. So can we somehow handle it a little bit better? And one thing is, of course, we can try to replace it by something because by just PPT condition, yeah, which would be just relaxation. But also we can go essentially take some trick that is useful, that is known for the separability problem, which is known as a method of relaxations or symmetric extensions. Yeah, so essentially it goes like that. If you have a separable state, you can write it by definition as like that. And if you can write a state like that, it's easy to extend one copy from Bob. Yeah, because if you can write down this state, you can easily extend just from BK. And that means I can go make the reverse direction. I can go say the following, okay, and let's try to find such a state now. Yeah, so I try to find such a state with the properties that if I trace out B prime or trace out B, it gives me my old state. And of course, it has to be a state, it has to be positive and normalized. And this is a test for the entanglement. And this I can somehow test also with a so-called semi-definite program, which is easy to implement. And then the idea is, can we take this trick also for the optimizations that I showed you before? So maybe go. So for this optimization, can we essentially replace the separability constraint by such a hierarchy? And we can. And actually, for noting that, it's also useful to note here the first point that essentially we're looking just for symmetric states, because the question that the trace of the flip operator is equal to one just means that this state is symmetric. And then we can just write down the formula, the general statement, and this goes like that. So it turns out essentially the following. Let's assume that the marginal problem has a solution. So there is a pure global state. Then this is the case if and only if, for all n, I can write down such an extension to n parties where this is a state and this obeys some marginal constraint. So we can essentially originally want to solve the marginal problem on this first part here. And then we essentially go, so this is, for instance, a 7-qubit state. And then we go to 14 qubits, to 21 qubits, and so on, and more and more and more, and look for a certain symmetric state on these three copies, four copies, and so on of the 7-qubit state. And if we find such a state for all n, then this marginal problem has a solution. And if it doesn't have a solution, there will be some n where we don't find such an extension anymore. Yeah, and in this way, this is something like a complete hierarchy for the marginal problem. So this is just a sequence of semi-definite programs, and you are guaranteed if you go to higher and higher orders, at some point you will either detect that there's no solution of this marginal problem, or if you can go arbitrarily well, you know that there must be a solution. Okay, so this is quite abstract. Now you may ask, can we really learn something from it? And for that, I will go back to this absolutely maximally entangled states, where we can now use some tricks from the absolutely maximally entangled states to simplify this problem. And how does this work? We essentially look at symmetries, yeah, because this is quite a general thing, but still we have some symmetries. So the general strategy is the following. So let's assume, I mean, we have this condition. Yeah, so we have, want the margins of the state want to be something like our conditional margins that we want to have. And let's assume that here one of these states obeys some symmetry. Then essentially we can directly argue that this state also has to obey some symmetry. So any symmetry in this sense of the marginal problem somehow extends to a symmetry on this extension phi that we want to find. And because now we have to look for some symmetric phi in a certain sense, that means that the set of possible phi that we have to consider becomes smaller. Yeah, because essentially we are getting more and more constraints, and each constraint makes the set smaller. And so the problem gets easier. And if we go now for the IME problem, actually it becomes even better, because first, for the absolute maximum entangled states, we essentially have two symmetries. So first, if you have an absolutely maximally entangled state and permute it, it will be still absolutely maximally entangled. The state itself is not symmetric. Yeah, I mean, these examples that are known, they are not symmetric states, but still it will be still an absolutely maximally entangled state. On the other hand, the other symmetry is that if you have an absolute maximally entangled state and apply some local unitary, it also will remain absolutely maximally entangled. And these are two symmetries which we know, which tell us something about the marginals. And now we can try to map them onto this state phi that we are looking for. And the funny thing, what turns out, is that under these symmetries, there's only one candidate for the state left. So essentially, this statement is following. An absolutely maximally entangled state exists if and only if some explicitly given operator phi, which we really can explicitly compute, is separable with respect to some bipartition. Yeah, so we still have to have the separability constraint from the match optimization, but actually we know only from the symmetries, there's only one candidate left. And of course, this is now an easy task. Yeah, you can just look at these operators, which we can explicitly write down. And well, you get pictures, and they look known in some sense. Well, because we look at this operator phi, and often it's just not a state, it's not a positive operator, or it's just NPT. Yeah, so it violates the PPT criterion, so it's obviously entangled. And for these cases, we know that the IME state cannot exist. And this reproduces all the results that are known from the IME problem, apart from one single example, namely this 7.2 case, which was this case that I told you before. There we get a state where we unfortunately cannot decide whether it's entangled or separable. I mean, we know it must be entangled because we know that the IME state doesn't exist, but we have no idea to prove it. Okay, so let me then finally give you two examples. So the first example is this point here of 4 6-dimensional system, which is an open case. And for that, you can directly write down the state. And here it is. So it's a bipartite problem. Alice and Bob have 4 6-dimensional systems. And I defined something like a maximally entangled state on the 6-dimensional system, and I defined something like the orthogonal projector. And then I can write down the state. And here I just, for convenience, I chose the partial transposition of the state already. Yeah. And the statement is very simple. This state, if this state is entangled, then this absolutely maximally entangled state does not exist. And if it's separable, then the IME state does exist. And you may see that in principle, this, because this is something like a maximally entangled state. Yeah, so essentially you can see it's something like a maximally entangled state plus some noise. So actually it's not such an ugly state. Yeah? Unfortunately, we still don't know if this is entangled and actually would like to know it because there's a price for it. Namely, there's a selection of 5 problems in quantum information theory by a paper by Horodetsky, Lukasz Kunitsky, and Karol Chatkowski. And one of these problems is essentially the problem of the 6-qubit, the 4-6-dimensional A&E state. So if you would prove that this state is entangled, you would get essentially 2021 euros, which is the price for this open, solving one of these open problems. And finally, I mean, if you want to, I mean, of course we tried and we failed. So we actually spent quite some time. If you're interested, I can tell you all the methods that we tried and which do not succeed. I mean, if you want to train a little bit, you should maybe look at a slightly simpler example, which is the 7-qubit state, because essentially this gives this state. So if you look for the 7-qubit INE problem, then we know it doesn't exist. So we can calculate the state, which is given by this thing. And we know that it must be entangled because the INE state doesn't exist. But actually, again, we do not have any method to prove the entanglement of the state directly. Yeah, again, also this we tried, of course, a lot because the idea was, of course, to find a criterion that proves that this state is entangled. And then hopefully this criterion also will prove that this 4Q hex state is entangled from the slide before, but it doesn't work. Yeah, so actually at the moment, I do not have any concrete criterion that proves that this given state is entangled. Okay, so these were the open problems essentially already, so I can conclude. So what did I tell you? So first I started with this A&E problem and I told you that not all absolutely maximum entangled state exist, but that it's an interesting problem related to quantum codes and to secret sharing and so on. Then I told you that this pure state marginal problem in general can be solved with the hierarchy of some semi-definite problems. And finally, I explained to you that this absolutely maximum entangled problem state problem is really equivalent to a specific separability problem of a specific state. Okay, so these are essentially the two main references where you can find this. Yeah, finally, I would like to thank, of course, my collaborators. So this is Xiao Dong. So here, see, this is Chao. Yeah, and unfortunately, the others are not on the picture. And finally, I would like to thank you for the attention. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you very much, Alfred. Now it's time for questions. There's one here in Discord. Remick was asking if you could explain why there are different blue colors in the table. What do they mean?
Ah, okay. Yes. Maybe I can just. So essentially, yeah, these were taken from this paper in JFSA in 2018. And there was essentially, because we, in this paper, we excluded some more AME state. And these were the light blue things here, essentially. So the dark blue things were excluded before and the light blue things were excluded in this paper. Yeah, so this is essentially that you provide a new bound and with that we could exclude this light blue things. So this was essentially the difference, but this was only relates to the specific paper.
So it doesn't mean whether the shadow inequalities do the job or not. But this is, in some cases they do, in some others they don't, but this has nothing to do with the colors. Is that correct?
Exactly, yes. Well, essentially, more or less all of these things are based on similarities, the shadow inequalities and the Zweig enumerators and so on. So essentially the methods for all these things are roughly the same, apart from the 7-qubit thing.
Well, the 7-qubit, the shadow inequality method doesn't work.
It doesn't work, no. Yeah, so actually this is maybe one thing that could be that our thing with the separability of this AME state and I mean, to reduce the separability problem. And then I said that essentially with this, if you then look for PPT, so you exclude everything apart from this AME 7-2K space, yeah? Which essentially suggests maybe that this is then somewhat equivalent to this shadow inequality. But okay, this is just
I see. I have a question. So when you were talking about this, the 7-qubit case, so basically you also mentioned that not only you show that it doesn't exist, but that you can give like the best approximate.
Yes.
Which I think the best approximate here means that it has as many reduced density matrices equal to the identity as possible, right?
Yes.
Well, if you think in the SDP hierarchy, you could give the approximation in the sense that the sum of the purities is as large as or as small as possible, right?
Yes. Actually, I mean, that's a good question. So in principle, I just want to say that, I mean, this is just, you can consider different approximations.
Yes.
Yeah. And this was just saying, okay, we want to have for as many density matrices as possible, we want to have that they're exactly equal to the maximally mixed state. And then this comes out. But of course, it could be that there's a state where more or less nearly all of them are close to the maximally mixed state. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But honestly, I would not know how to determine the any bounds.
So the SDP hierarchy you have wouldn't work for that.
I would need to think. The problem is essentially the following. I mean, if we have this SDP hierarchy, I mean, we can only apply to this AME states because we can simplify due to symmetries. If you have such a problem for 7 qubits and just have that the purity is somehow large or small, but you don't have the exact symmetries, I think it will be much, much more difficult.
Okay.
Yeah, so that's maybe, I would need to think. So was it that it's possible to get a bound on that. But if you don't have the exact symmetries, I think it's getting much, much more difficult.
I see. Okay, there's one more question here. Remy was asking, is it known whether all AME states are graph states? I think you mentioned something like that during the talk, but I missed it.
Yes, so it seems to be that the answer is no. And there was yesterday a poster here, which for technical reasons I could not attend, but yes, I will try to see this poster this evening. Where they essentially, as far as I saw, they say that you can have two AME states which are not SLOCC equivalent, which means that they cannot be graph states, because graph states for them, SLOCC equivalence or it's always LU equivalence. So please look at this poster. Yeah, so, but this is what I roughly got from that.
Okay, so I guess there are no more questions. So thank you very much again, Otfried.
Okay, thanks.